Hello students, today we'll see chapter 2, that is Laws of Partnership. This chapter is based on Indian Partnership Act 1932. We'll also see LLP Act, that is 2008. So we're gonna look at partnership, features of partnership, types of partners, dissolution, modes of dissolution. We'll then discuss about LLP. What is nature of an LLP, procedure of incorporation of an LLP, advantages, what are provisions for financial disclosures by LLP. So it's very easy. We have learned this long back. A partnership is an arrangement where parties known as partners agree to cooperate to advance their mutual interests. Partnership is a relation between parties who have agreed to share profits of the businesses carried on by all or any of them acting for all. So basically, partnership is a business between two or more people. So where two or more people come together to conduct a business, to do activities of business, and then ultimately they earn profits or they bear losses together. That is known as partnership. It's very simple. Features of partnership, it's very easy. Number of persons required is minimum two, maximum 10 for a banking business, maximum 20 for a non-banking business. Contractual relationship, you'll have to make a contract, you'll have to make an agreement. A written agreement is always preferred, though registration is not compulsory. A registered partnership firm has more value compared to any other organization in the market. It does not have any legal status, which simply means that the two people who are involved in the business, the government will look at this organization with those two people only. I mean, the firm will not get a separate name or a separate status. Whatever these two people are there, it's the firm. That's it. So they don't have separate status. They share profits, they bear losses also. The liability of partners is unlimited, means in case there's a loss or there's a big amount to be paid, even their personal properties will be taken away from them. They'll have to do a legal business. It is an implied agency, which means where the two people are working, if one person is not at work, it is understood that the other person has to carry out that activity. So it is an implied agency, which means that so it means that one person is principal and the other person is agent. So there's no separate notice to be given to anybody. It is very well understood. If two people are running a business, when one person is doing something else, the other person has to carry out some other activity, and each other they have to support. We cannot transfer our interest. Transfer of shares cannot be done. There's nothing like transfer of ownership or interest. It is not possible. And utmost good faith is the basic, is the foundation of a partnership. Now we look at different types of partners. We have actual partner, that is the active partner who is actively involved into the business. Then we have dormant partner. This is something called as sleeping partner. This person puts money and he is not interested in doing the business. He'll put money and he'll get the revenue. He's a sleeping partner. Then there is nominal partner. There are people who, you know, take some 5% share or 10% share, but they give their name. Usually these are very famous people like politicians or celebrities. So they tell that, yeah, this is my business. They promote it as their business. They are not involved into any business activity. They don't participate in the business. They might take some money or they might take some share. So they might even not take the money. This is also possible. This is just nominal partner. They are there as partners to show to the world that this business is my business. Then there is partners for profits only. This is a case where the partner is taken into the business, and only when there is a profit he will be a partner. If there's a loss, he will not be taking that loss. So it's a very odd situation, usually not you know, chosen like that, but okay, fine. Then sub partner is usually a minor, a person who's under 18 years old. He gets an opportunity, or maybe a substitute partner. Then partner by estoppel is a situation where we act as a partner. So there are people, like usually we have managers working in our company. They will take maximum decisions in front of the customers and the vendors, and they'll act as partners. And then minor partner is someone who's below 18 years old. So these are different types of partners. Now we'll talk about dissolution and what is mode of dissolution. Dissolution means shutting the firm, ending the firm. So liquidation, winding up, closing down of a firm, that is dissolution. And what are the modes of dissolution? Now how to dissolve? You have to do an agreement. So there's no need for a written agreement. If three or four of your partners have decided that, okay, we may not continue the business anymore, the firm can be dissolved. By a notice, one of the partners or all of the partners can give notice to each other telling that we don't want to continue the business and we want to dissolve it. On contingencies, it means some kinds of emergency, which means there is an emergency that is created due to which they have to dissolve the firm. Then compulsory dissolution, situation is such that we have borne so many losses, now we have to dissolve so that we sell the assets and give back money to the people. And finally, dissolution by court, which means the court forces us to dissolve and it is a mandate, it's a legal thing, it's by law which we have to follow. Now we'll go to LLP. What is LLP? What is nature of an LLP? LLP means limited liability partnership. So limited liability partnership means a partnership formed and registered under the Limited Liability Partnership Act 2008. It suggests the name only, na? Limited liability partnership. It's like partnership. The only difference is that in normal partnership, the liability is unlimited. In limited liability partnership, the liability is limited. So nature of an LLP, it's a body corporate. The interesting thing is that LLP gets an identity. Partnership doesn't get any identity. So it's a body corporate. It does not come under the Indian Partnership Act 1932, though the complete act is based on Indian Partnership Act 1932. Minimum number of partners is 2. Maximum can go up to 200. There is something called as designated partner. We have to tell that, okay, we both are partners and we both are designated partners. So this is the name that is given to a partner. What are the liabilities of a designated partner? It is limited. We are protected by the Limited Liability Partnership Act 2008. In case the firm gets dissolved, our personal property will not be taken. Okay, so there could be changes in designated partner. We can decide that, okay, he's the designated partner or I'm the designated partner. And there are punishments decided for contravention of Section 789. This is one of the major participation of LLP. What is the procedure of incorporation? How you can register an LLP? First, you need to obtain a director's identification number, that's a DIN. After that, you have to register a digital signature. You need to have an online digital signature. Then filing of Form 1 for name availability. You have to fill a form to check what is the name that you have decided for your limited liability partnership. Is that name available? Filing of Form 2 for incorporation and subscription. You have to fill Form 2 for checking whether registration can be done, what is the subscription procedure. Then you have to draft an agreement, an LLP agreement, which will be written about terms, okay, how many partners, what will be the sharing ratio, what is the capital ratio, everything. And filing of Form 3, that will be the final LLP agreement. That will be the final filing of Form 3. So we need to draft and then file. Okay, so this is the procedure of incorporation of an LLP. What are the advantages of an LLP? It is very easy to form. The liability is limited. Perpetual succession means continuous. The business has to remain continuous. Flexible to manage. It is very easy to manage. These are the advantages. Easily transferable ownership, which means we can transfer the ownership very easily. Just a moment. Okay, separate property. It's a separate identity. We need to show a property there that we are doing a business on. We have to follow the rules of taxation. So it's a protected organization. We can raise the money very easily. We can sue anybody. Anybody can sue us in reverse also. There is no requirement of an audit by taxation, like how it has happened in a limited company or a joint stock company. And partners are not agents of other partners. Everybody has got its own duties and we are not representing each other. So these are a lot of benefits. These benefits are based out of what are the mistakes in the partnership firm. So perpetual succession means the business is ongoing. whether the partner remains or not. So, but if in a partnership firm, if you see, if one partner is dead, if he is insolvent, then the business will stop. Here it is not the case. The business will have to continue. It can continue without one partner also. Okay, and there'll be another partner coming in. So these are some protection. What happens if you are registered on an LLP? You are able to gain more trust by the customers, by the suppliers, and all that. Now, what are the financial disclosures that have to be made by an LLP? An LLP has to maintain books of accounts and other records. It's not mandatory by a partnership, but an LLP definitely we have to maintain books of accounts. You have to file an annual return. There could be an inspection of documents which has to be submitted to the registrar of the companies. There is a penalty for a false statement. Power of registrar for obtaining information. They also need to, the registrar has the power to obtain information whenever he feels that, okay, I need to know what is going on in the organization. Compounding of offenses. If you do a few offenses together, you may get a compounding punishment also. Destruction of old records, enforcement of duty to make returns. So all these things are the provisions which are required for financial disclosures by limited liability partnership. So which means that in order to run a limited liability partnership, you have to follow all these rules. So this is where we are done with partnership firm and partnership limited liability partnership. I'll just run through what we have done. So we have discussed what is a partnership, what are the features, what are the types of partners, dissolution and modes of dissolution, what is an LLP, nature of an LLP, procedure of incorporation of an LLP, advantages of an LLP, provisions for financial disclosures by LLP. So we have run through what is partnership. We'll move to the next topic, that is chapter 3, that is Sale of Goods Act. So this is another act, Sale of Goods Act 1930. This is based on the Contract Act 1872. So we'll talk about what is contract of sale, what are the essentials of a contract of sale, what is a sale and essentials of a valid sale, what do you mean by unpaid seller and rights of unpaid seller, what are the remedial measures of unpaid seller, what is the meaning of condition and warranty, and what is the meaning of implied conditions. We'll see all these topics. So what is contract of sale and essentials of a contract of sale? A contract of sale is a legal document, an exchange of goods, services, or property to be exchanged from seller to buyer for an agreed upon value in money paid or the promise to pay same. So it's normal, it's a normal contract. Okay, it's a legal contract, but here we are dealing with goods only, goods, services, or property. The money value is agreed upon, it's a written contract. So what are the essentials? As good as any contract. So we have learned about essentials of a valid contract that are applicable. So contract require two parties. There has to be goods, services, or property in between. Transfer of property, that means whoever is the earlier owner will now transfer the property in the name of the new owner, and there is a price to be paid. These are the essentials of a contract of a sale. Without this, we can't sell. So you can't sell if there's no contract. You can't sell if there are no two parties. You can't sell if there's no property. You can't sell if you don't transfer the property. You can't sell if there's no price for it. What is the sale and essentials of a valid sale? So when the seller transfer the property and the goods immediately to the buyer, there is a sale. Essentials of a valid sale. Again, if you want to make a sale valid, you need goods, you need price, you need two parties, transfer, and essentials of a valid contract. We already know what are the essentials of a valid contract from chapter 1 that we have gone through. So when seller transfer the property in the goods immediately to buyer, then it is sale. So suppose if I sold goods to you and now you can prove that you are the owner, that means it is sale. We'll understand what is the meaning of unpaid seller and rights of unpaid seller. Okay, so we'll see unpaid seller and rights of unpaid seller. So if a seller sells goods to buyer and the buyer does not pay the amount of purchased goods to the seller, then he is an unpaid seller. It's very simple. So if I have sold goods to you, okay, and you are the buyer, and you do not pay the amount of the goods to me, back to me, then I am an unpaid seller because I have sold, but you know, I don't have the money. So till the time I get the money, I am an unpaid seller. It's very easy. What kind of rights do I possess as an unpaid seller? What can I do? So as an unpaid seller, if you have not paid it to me, I have a few list of rights. I can do certain things. Okay. So what can I do? I have a right of lien, which means I still own the goods. I still have the ownership of the goods, which means I can still have some right on the goods that are there. So suppose if I have sold a laptop to you, so the laptop, I've given you the laptop, I'm waiting for the payment. Now you have not yet paid me and you are still delaying. I still am the owner of the laptop. I have not transferred the title in your name. I have not given you the invoice. I have not given you the bill. I have not given, you're just using the laptop. You've taken the laptop from me, but you're still not the owner. And I can still ask for money from people telling that, okay, this is my laptop. I want to keep it to you as a mortgage or anything. So I can still have the ownership. I still have the lien. Then right of stoppage of goods in transit. So when I say that the goods are in transit, okay, that means the goods are moving from one place to another. I have sold the goods to you. I have loaded the goods in the truck. The truck has moved from place A, let's say Delhi, and it's going to place B, that is Mumbai. Now the goods are in transit. Can I stop those goods if I wish? Of course I can. I have that right. If you are not going to make the payment, I have the right to stop it, or even till the time you make the payment. This is, we are just talking about the rights that I possess. Can I stop it? The answer is yes. Can I have an ownership, still ownership? Yes. Can I resell? Of course I can, because even though the goods, are the title is not yet transferred, the goods are, let's say goods are with you, but can I resell it to someone? Of course I can do it. So these are the rights of an unpaid seller. Okay, so who is an unpaid seller? The one who has sold the goods. The goods might be in my possession as a seller or buyer's possession as a seller, but till the time I am paid, I am an unpaid seller. What do I have as rights of an unpaid seller? Yes, I have a right of lien. That means I can still be an owner. I have a right of stoppage of goods in transit. If my goods are traveling, let's say from a ship, I can stop it whenever I want. And I can sell it also to anyone else. While I have sold it to you, I can sell it to someone else also. Now we talk about remedial measures of unpaid seller. Now there are rights, couple of rights explained in a manner that one is rights against the goods that I have, and the other is right against the buyer. Till the time and I'm an unpaid seller, I have certain rights towards the goods and I have certain rights towards the buyer. Okay, so we'll try and understand this particular part. What kind of remedies are there? What kind of solutions are there for unpaid seller? Okay, so now the remedies that I have is against the goods and against the buyer. So right of lien, we have discussed this. Right of lien means, do I have the ownership of the goods? Of course, yes. Now this is against the goods I'm talking about. Can I still own the goods? Yes. Okay. Can I stop the goods? Yes, I can. Can I send it for resale? Of course I can. So these are the rights against the goods. Now we'll talk about rights against the buyer. Whoever is the buyer, let's say I've sold goods to someone who's sitting in Delhi and the goods are going from Mumbai. Okay. And the goods are going to reach to Delhi to some time. So here what happens is, what kind of a right do I have against the buyer who's purchased it, who's sitting at Delhi? Can I file a case against him for the price? Yes. If he does not make a payment, let's say I had given him a time of 15 days. Till 15 days, he's not made me payment. So because he's not made a payment, I'm an unpaid seller. So can I file a case against him? Yes, I can file a case against him for the price of the goods. I'll tell to the court that this person has purchased goods from me and he's not made the payment. I want the payment. Simple. I don't want anything. I just want the payment. So court will call him, will send him a notice, and this processes will begin to move on, and I will get my money. I am filing a case against him only for the price, that is for the money. There's another way of filing a case is filing a case for damages. So here I might tell that, okay, I lost a better deal. Okay, I sold the goods to you for 1 lakh. I was about to sell the, maybe in between I got another customer who was purchasing it for 1 lakh. 30,000. So 30,000 more. I lost 30,000 because of this guy. So I tell to the court that, okay, you have to see to it that I get that 30,000 from him as damages also, along with the price of 1 lakh rupees. Let me get the 30,000 part also. Then repudiation of a contract before due date. Now suppose there is a due date of let's say delivery. So let's say I have not yet done the delivery, okay, and I told him that I will be able to deliver the goods to you on the 15th of June, but the payment has to come to me by 10th of June, and let's say today is 9th of June. So tomorrow, if I don't get the payment, can I cancel the contract? Yes, because the due date is still there, 15, but the payment date was 5 days before, which has not happened. I still have the right against the buyer, and I'm still an unpaid seller. I'm still not got my money back, money here. So if I've not got my money, can I repudiate the contract? Can I cancel the contract? Yes, I can easily cancel the contract. Can I sue him for interest? Which means, can I file a case against the buyer telling the court that my money, which I have not got for 15 days or 1 month, whatever money I'm going to get, 1 lakh rupees, I want an interest rate also to be charged on that money. So I may say that, okay, 1 lakh rupees he's supposed to give. He's delayed it for 1 month. Charge him an interest of, as per the market rate, let's say 6% per annum. For 1 month, I want the interest also on that amount. So whatever is the amount per month wise, I'll get as an interest also. So can I file a case against the buyer asking the court to allow to get the interest also? Yes. So there are two kinds of rights that I possess. One is against the goods. The other is against the buyer. So this is what are the remedies for unpaid sellers. Now we'll understand what is the meaning of condition and warranty. We all are aware of such terms. So we know something like guarantee. We have heard such words like warranty. We all are mobile phone users, and we very well are aware of such words. So what is a condition and what is a warranty? So a condition is a stipulation essential to the main purpose of the contract, the breach of which gives rise to a right to treat the contract as repudiated. It is very simple. So if I say I want to purchase a mobile phone with 8 GB RAM and 128 GB space, this is my primary condition, okay, and I have chosen the phone model, everything. Now what happens is that when the actual delivery is there coming in my hand, I am seeing that the phone is 128 GB in space, but it is not 8 GB RAM, it is 6 GB RAM. Okay, so can I now return the product telling that I don't want to continue the contract, I want to repudiate it, I want to cancel it? Can I do that? Of course, yes, because it is a condition. Condition is a stipulation which is essential to the main purpose of a contract. Why did I actually buy? My main requirement was 8 GB and 128 GB. If I don't get that fulfilled, that means the main condition is hampered. So condition is very simple, that without which I cannot do the transaction. This is my basic requirement. It is connected to the main purpose of the contract. If I breach this, that means it is not correct. So I can easily cancel the contract. That is, I can repudiate the contract. Now what is a warranty? A warranty is a stipulation collateral to the main purpose of the contract, the breach of which gives rise to a claim for damages, but not to reject the goods and treat the contract repudiated. So with the help of warranty, can I cancel the contract? Can I repudiate the contract? The answer is no, we cannot cancel the contract. So it is very simple. So let's say I purchased a phone and they say that, okay, with this you get a 6 month warranty for repair, which means if the phone gets damaged in certain way and if there's a repair requirement, we will do that, okay. And they also mention very clearly that these are the things which will be repaired and these are the things which will not be repaired. So if you want, you can take it, and it has a 1 year warranty. Let's say they are talking about software only. If the phone has some software problem, we'll cover it for 1 year. So that's the kind of warranty you have. The phone is in warranty. If there is anything problem, like a phone gets hanged or anything, we'll cover that. Now, if there is a problem in the phone and you take the phone to the service center and they deny you the service, they say, no, this is not possible. We are not going to provide you the service, and it is still according to the contract, according to the warranty information, it is still coming under that rule. Then you cannot say that, okay, take the phone back, you have broken the warranty. No, you can't return the phone, you can't cancel the contract. But what you can do is you can file a case with the warranty. You can file a case against the mobile phones seller, telling that he had given a warranty of 6 months, 1 year, and he's not fulfilling that, and I have damages because a lot of my business information was there in the phone. I have faced these many losses, and I want some money from the mobile phone seller. That is what you can do. You cannot cancel the contract, but because it is not related to the main purpose of the contract, you can easily claim for damages, but you cannot reject the goods and you cannot treat the contract repudiated. This is what is the difference between a condition and a warranty. So now, what do you mean by implied conditions? Now, see, it's very easy and simple to understand. When you buy a certain product, when you buy a certain commodity, certain things are very well understood. There's no need to explain. These are certain implied conditions, means automatically they come. Implied means automatic condition. So when I say, let's say I want to buy a phone, condition as to title. It is very simple. I should get the title, na? Title means you write a bill in my name. The moment the bill comes in my name, I become the owner. If I do not get the bill in my name, then I'll not be an owner. So do I need to explain it to someone, give it to you in my name? No. It is a automatic thing that you have to give it in my name. Second, sale by description. Whatever you described, it should be there. If you are telling 128 GB space, it should be there. If you are telling 8 GB RAM, it should be there. If you are telling 50 megapixel camera, front camera, it should be there. Whatever you described, it should be there. Okay, and if it is not there, you are breaking basic automatic conditions. So condition as to quality or fitness. So whatever quality you are showing written, it should be there. Condition as to merchantability, which means it should not happen that the product that I've bought suddenly bursts in my pocket. It should be saleable in a proper condition also, right? Conditioned implied by custom. Custom is the procedure is very simple. I make the payment, you give me the phone, then you give me the receipt, and that's how the transaction is done. But you are not giving me the receipt, or maybe you're not accepting cash payment, but that is how the customs are. That is how transactions are done. So why are you changing the customs now? Sale by sample. See, some products are bought by sample. So they'll show you, okay, this much, let's say 10 gram of rice they will show. Based on that, you can buy 50 kg rice. So if the sample is of that rice, the main product has to be of that rice. You cannot change it. So if you're showing a sample of one product, the actual product also should be from that particular thing. Okay, see, these are automatic conditions. Nobody has to separately go and tell that you did not follow this condition, and this comes automatically. Condition as to wholesomeness. Wholesomeness means it should be full, it should be total. If you are telling that, okay, it comes with a charger, it comes with a earphone, it should come with a charger and a earphone. It should come with all the, it comes with a cover, it comes with a screen guard, then everything should come. So that's how I should get the product. So these are certain automatic conditions, implied conditions, for which we need not give any separate explanation that, okay, I want this, I want that. Why to tell? This is what we usually get. So this is the meaning of implied conditions. Now, this is where we are done with third chapter. I'll quickly run through what all we have discussed from the beginning. So we decided to discuss what is the sale of goods. This is based on Sale of Goods Act 1930. We discuss what is contract of sale, essentials of contract of sale and essentials of a valid sale, unpaid seller, rights of unpaid seller, then remedies of unpaid seller. Then we saw condition and warranty is different, then implied condition. So contract of sale, two parties, okay, contract is similar to Contract Act. Then sale and essentials of a valid sale. We saw what is unpaid seller, what are the rights of an unpaid seller. We also saw the remedial measures of unpaid seller. So rights are divided into two parts, that is rights against the goods and rights against the buyer. Okay, then we saw condition and warranty. What is the difference between a condition and warranty? We also saw what are the implied or automatic conditions. So with this, I end today's chapter. I'll see you in the next class. Thank you.